good afternoon. My name is Keone Hughes, and over the past few years, I've had the incredible joy and honor and privilege of serving as the pastor of Grace Community Church, which is where Dave and Joy called their home church. Such an honor to know them, to have served alongside of them. Many of the Muellers still attend our church, and I'm so grateful for you all. On behalf of the Mueller family, I want to thank each of you for coming today to honor the life of Joy and the life of Dave, to pay your respects, and to also thank the Lord for the service that they have provided to him and to so many in this room, to celebrate their homegoing, to celebrate the fact that they have inherited eternal life and they have claimed the crown of glory. This is shocking, tragic, and sudden, and yet for the Lord, it wasn't unexpected. And yet for many of us, we continue to grieve. I'd first like to start off by saying I'm so sorry to the boys, to the girls, to the family who are gathered here for this incredible loss. I know that in the days and weeks and years to come, you'll spend much time putting this back together. But I want you to know that everybody in this room loves you so, so much. We love you very much. A few housekeeping items before we pray to open the rest of the service. First off, I'd like to thank Calvary Church for so graciously allowing this time for us to gather to grieve. It's a great reminder that we are all part of the greater church pushing forward the gospel of Jesus Christ together, just as Dave and Joy did so wonderfully in Kenya and in so many other places in the world. Secondly, I want to note that Kenya Hope is opening a memorial project and has opened a memorial project in honor of Dave and Joy. And on your programs, you'll be able to find a QR code that will send you to a website where you can begin donating. The family has asked that instead of donations or flowers, that in lieu of those items, you would be able to actually support the ongoing work of Kenya Hope that Dave and Joy loved so very much. With that being said, would you please bow with me in a word of prayer? Father, we come before you this afternoon with hearts that are torn and rent. Lord, the reality of loss is still setting in for many of us and feels distant. And yet, Lord Jesus, we come together to grieve, to acknowledge, Lord, lives that were lost. And yet, Lord Jesus, lives that gained eternal glory in the inheritance of their Lord Jesus Christ. Father, today we ask that as we honor your servants, Dave and Joy, Lord, that they truly would be honored. And yet, Lord, I know that their desire would be that you would be magnified in this service today. And so, Jesus, we pray that you would truly exalt yourself among us this afternoon, that we would fall more in love with you, that we would be those who look at the lives of Dave and Joy, and that in our honoring of them and remembering them, Lord, that we would be called to go as well. Father, I pray for strength for those who share. Father, I pray for strength for all of us who grieve. We lift all of this up to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And we all said, amen.
David Martin Mueller, March 10, 1962 to October 25, 2023. Joy Marie Mueller, August 27 of 62 to October 25 of 23. David and Joy Mueller entered into the glory of God together October 25 due to a tragic car accident while serving as missionaries in Kenya. Both were 61 years old and had enjoyed 39 years of marriage. Having crossed the finish line and inherited their crowns of glory, they now hear the words, "Well done, my good and faithful servants." Matthew 25:23. Dave was born to Wesley and Barbara Mueller on March 10 of 1962 in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Dave was the youngest of three and was passionate about fishing from a young age. Although he struggled with dyslexia, he loved reading fishing magazines and learned best through his passion. From a young age, he worked with his hands and could build and fix anything. He graduated from Wyoming High School in 1980. Joy was born to Alfred and Nancy Miller on August 27 of 1962 in Grand Rapids. She was the youngest of four and always had an energetic, bubbly personality. Her love language has always been cooking. She was an absolute marvel in the kitchen. And she seemed to have an endless store of energy and practical love. Joy graduated from Grand Rapids Baptist Academy in 1980. Dave and Joy met at Newhall Baptist Church, where their families had attended since they were both little. They eloped September 7th, 1984, to get paperwork started so Joy could go with Dave on his deployment to Germany as a crewman in the Army. They had a ceremony with friends and family on February 22nd of 1985. Dave and Joy have three sons, along with their three daughters-in-law, Ian and Stephanie, Forrest and Alexa, and Cameron and Tori. They have four grandsons, Cade, 3 years old, Emmett, 2 years old, Solomon, 1.5 years old, and Pierce, who is 4 weeks old. They were so proud of all their sons, their daughters by marriage, and their grandsons. They loved spending time with each other and their family, going on adventures, spending time outdoors, and staying physically fit.
In 1992, Dave and Joy graduated from the Missionary Training Center of New Tribes Mission in Missouri. They started their missionary journey in Papua New Guinea, doing Bible translation work among the tribes. All three of their boys grew up on the mission field. Their family time was mostly spent exploring in the surrounding nature, fishing, swimming, scuba diving. In 2006, Dave and Joy moved their family to war-ravaged southern Sudan, where they worked with closed-door mission ministries and partners in compassionate care to build a hospital. Here, Dave worked with his hands to build a hospital with limited resources, and Joy started ministering to the numerous widows in the area. In 2010, Dave and Joy were appointed executive directors of Kenya Hope, where they served faithfully for 13 years. Through their work with Kenya Hope, they provided clean water, widow skill training, student sponsorship, drought-driven food relief, and audio Bibles to the Maasai people in rural Kenya and in the Kibera slums. Joy was called Mama by hundreds in Kenya and was dearly, dearly loved by her widows. Dave was looked up to by so many young men who worked alongside him to build water towers, solar systems, school buildings, irrigation, etc., etc. Dave and Joy are preceded in death by Dave's father, Wesley, and Joy's mother, Nancy. They are survived by Dave's mother, Barbara, and his sister, Sharon, Randy, brothers Steve, Shelley. They are also survived by Joy's father, Alfred, her brother Tom, sister Grace, and brother John. They will be lovingly missed by their children, Ian, Stephanie, Forrest, Alexa, and Cameron and Tori, as well as their four grandchildren, Cade, Emmett, Solomon, and Pierce. This is a quote from Dave. I took a few more minutes from my perch to process my feelings and contemplate the lesson I had just experienced. Dying to self and our own agendas. I am even more humbled and honored that God continues to use me, a flawed human, to bring his message of love and hope to others. Once again, I've learned in the school of faith, there are no graduates, only interns. David Mueller, September 2023, in the Kenya Hope newsletter.
Our first scripture is 2 Timothy 4, 6-8. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his coming. The second scripture is Matthew 16, 24 through 27. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is my strength of my heart and my portion forever. The word of the Lord.
Let's stand together as we remember.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow well, it is well.
be seated.
A little bit like a lamb to the slaughter right now, but that's okay. Mom and Dad's passing came as a shock to all of us. But to be truthful, the method is the most surprising. A car accident. They were supposed to die at sea. Thank you all for coming. Mom would be thrilled. She'd want to talk to all of you. Dad would be embarrassed that you all turned up, and he'd want to go sand something. A life on the field teaches you to be grateful about much. That was my childhood on the field, multiple fields, Papua New Guinea in the bush, on the base in Hoskins, the capital city of Port Moresby, a rather dangerous place at the time, Southern Sudan, sometimes a dangerous place. You could become grateful for things like running water, electricity, fresh produce, milk that's not a powder, unless you're Forrest, then you're grateful for that too, because you're weird. And a roof, even if it's made out of grass and termites fall on you. Gratitude is important. So with that said, I'm grateful for a lot of things. I'm grateful for a childhood beyond compare. Memories that are going to last a lifetime. Beautiful memories. Islands, oceans, jungle, savanna. I don't think I have time to dip into any stories on those fronts. I could talk for a lot of time about a lot of things. Incomparable love. Like the humidity in New Guinea, it filled everywhere. And then gratitude to all of you. There's some Newhall people here, Jenison people, I think there's some people from Granville Bible, all walks of life. Thank you for being here. Thank you for sending them. Thank you for commissioning them. Thank you for praying for them. Thank you for supporting them. You judged rightly 30, almost 40 years ago. You judged very rightly. Luke 16 talks about a shrewd manager. It's a very odd parable. I haven't heard a pastor give a super satisfying interpretation of it. And I think partly that's because it's one of the few scriptures where the interpretation is lived, like the Bible itself. Mom and Dad, I think, are a good example. All of you here, but then this crowd is a lot bigger in Kenya as well. And there's several other crowds around the world. So I think that that is a good place to start, is with gratitude and the knowledge that they stacked up for themselves rewards. Dad often said, and I think the brothers will say it as well, that he was selfish for those rewards. And that was one of the things that drove him. To hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," he pined for it. Dad tried to run away to Alaska as a child. He had a strange fascination with that place, when you consider the places he ended up. But that's okay. He was a man of contradictions, if anything. But he always liked sled dogs. And fortunately, a year or two ago, he and Mom got to go to Alaska. And they got to see some of those things. And we're grateful for that completion. But I'm going to cheat a little throughout this. Steve Holman graciously brought Mom and Dad's phones back. And while there's information in there that we wanted, the main thing that we wanted was Mom's little quote section from Dad. He had a very funny sense of humor. We can't repeat most of it up here for the sake of the women. But I'm going to pull some of those quotes. Not all of them are from him. Some of them were just ones that mutually inspired both of them. This one is from an Iditarod competitor. "I'm not interested in living safe. I'm interested in living full." I think they did. So 30 years of exceptional service, in part thanks to you people. So on behalf of the Mueller family, thank you. One of Dad's favorite verses, and funnily enough, we had some support this morning and are getting ready. Our friend Megan mentioned a verse that had popped into her head or that she had come across early in the morning, and it was the same verse. Proverbs 14:4, "Where there are no oxen, the manger is clean, but abundant crops, harvest, come by the strength of the ox." Translation: if you want to get things done, you're going to make a mess. There's going to be unsavory things on the floor, and it's not going to be clean and perfect. They believed that the call of Scripture was clear, and they said yes to that. Now the quote: God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And in the process of becoming qualified, you're going to make a mess. At the time, Mom and Dad said they were called to New Guinea, and I believe that. But over the years, with consistency, they stated quite clearly there was no personal calling to one place or people, only the call and the willingness to go to those places, to the places where the need was great. To describe them, humility and diligence, and I would add competency to that as well. They were ready to learn. They learned many skills, an inordinate number of skills, and they put them to use well for the service of those who needed it most. And it showed. I've been told on multiple occasions by believers and unbelievers alike, without exaggeration, and with full confidence that I'm bragging, that they were the real deal, real missionaries, real believers. As their son, someone who lived with them a lot, through a lot, they are speaking the truth. There were no double standards. There was no "do as I say, not as I do." For Dad, I don't know a ton about Dad's childhood. Grandma says that he was a pistol. And there was all kinds of fun stories about that, and I'm eager to hear more as we go. But God's grace transformed him. But he had a wild side, and he was put to good use in the wild. One of his favorite quotes that he spoke often of, mainly to us children, he spoke of a highway, sometimes a river. When you get into a highway, or into a river, onto a highway, you don't dictate where you're going. The highway or the river takes you. So be careful which one you get into, because it'll take you somewhere you might not be needing to go. So exit it if you can and get onto the path. He struggled to own anything as part of that, except tools. Tools are cool. He was cool with tools. Jesus had tools, etc. Except he didn't have Makita, but that's okay. I believe he embodied as best as he could in the world, not of the world. It's odd to watch a man be completely burdened by that idea, to know that you need to own things to live and that you have expectations to meet, but that those things are a burden to you, that they hinder your mission. That was a constant problem. It's weird having someone have that problem because they're the only person you know that has that problem. He would go to Kenya often with a full bag, and he would come back. His bag would still be full, but that was Mom's fault because she put stuff in it to sell. But his bags would come back empty, and he would borderline come back with the clothes on his back. If you look through those pictures, there are every article of clothing that we ever gave him, and every article of clothes that Mom either bought for him or thrifted is now being worn by a Kenyan. Shoes, jackets, shirts. He used to want to trade, but he got ringworm once in New Guinea. So he just stuck to giving the clothes away. He loved his boys, and he was surprised and sideswiped by how much he loved his grandsons. He loved the word. We've lost count of how many times he's been through it now. I had on his phone, one of his browsers, daily Bible, Psalms, Proverbs, Old Testament, New Testament. He was a week ahead on read through 30, 20. We don't even know anymore. He loved God's people. And they're all his people. And he wanted to serve those who had needs the most. Mom. Few fit their name as well as she. Joy. She did it well. I could waste a lot of time, but out of consideration for my siblings, I will, and for yourselves, I will withhold sharing everything she was good at. It was a lot, and then there was more. I was updated even recently of another skill that I was aware she possessed, but I did not know that she was revered at being the best at it as well. Radio and handling logistics amongst calls over radio. It's difficult to remember a time before cell phones and immediate messaging, but sometimes you have a block of communication. It's about 2 hours long. It's all you get that day or that week. You got to get a lot done. Having the right person there makes a world of difference to make you feel seen, heard, and connected with. Excellence in everything. She led Kenya Hope with excellence. She helped lead our family with Dad with excellence. She did that so well and so often, she blew a gasket. Not on us boys, but in her brain. She had a cranial bleed, 2006, 2005, in the 2000s somewhere. So she knew that her limit, she could literally work beyond the limits of her body. So God had to inform her of her limits. She had to run Kenya Hope yet. I could share a lot more stories about both of them. But I think as far as a son goes, I'll speak to how she helped save me in one small sense. I'm intensely dyslexic. It's not a death sentence or anything, but it can make your childhood awkward and difficult. So my second time going through fourth grade, I still could not read. Obviously, I can read now, so praise God for that, and praise God for her. The program, she learned that program. She was taught it on the fly. She learned it on the fly. And then she executed it over about a year. I don't think I've cried so much in my life as I did in those little classes, the two of us bawling our eyes out at each other, trying to figure out how to rewire a middle school boy's brain so that it can comprehend the world around it. But by the grace of God and with her determination and kindness and love, she did. And I am now literate and many more things, and I have her and my father to thank. You all knew her. You knew her qualities. You judged rightly. What you saw was what you got. It was self-evident. There was no smoke and mirrors there. That was her, through and through. Thanksgiving is in 19 days. We're going to be very mournful and sad, but we're going to have a lot of gratitude as well. And we're going to eat a meal. My mom cooked that meal. It's waiting for us. She and Dad are both waiting for us. So thank you, all of you. You judged rightly, and you equipped two of the best of us. And we will miss them. I will miss them. But thank you.
Thanks, Ian, for making me tear up early. I think Ian put it very appropriately. We have nothing but gratitude for everyone here, everyone who couldn't be here and overseas, either watching the live stream or the recorded version of this. Through this all, just had immense gratitude for the life my parents led for us and let us be a part of. In the fall of 2005, David Mueller was sitting on the edge of his bed in South Sudan, wondering how he could bring his kids to such a desolate place as he killed yet another scorpion running over his shoes. Months later, with his family in tow, he watched his three boys make a sport out of catching those scorpions. Later in life, in his own way, he voiced to me his own internal struggle with giving his family a comfortable, safe, convenient life, but answering the call placed upon his heart. The reality is he gave us the greatest childhood we could ever ask for. By watching him serve the Lord, living out his faith, but never at the cost of his own family either. The harsher the environment, the greater the task, the stronger we all became, by relying on the Lord for strength and guidance. My mother, Joy, as many of you know, was a woman filled with unmeasurable amounts of joy, grace, patience, particularly towards her husband. Whether it was needing to cook and house for 30 guests at the drop of a hat, or giving medicine to the local tribal crazy person, or dispatching a python in her son's crib. She always did with a cool calm, a slightly wry smile, but she never seemed to falter. I saw her try to breathe life back into a man struck by lightning. Cameron can speak a little further into that. I saw her attempt to pull out a fishing hook out of my father's arm. We had to rely on the village strongman for that one. If you got to know her a little bit, you also learned not to cross her. Or she could drop you on the ground faster than a newborn giraffe. Just ask Ian. They learned 4 languages, and were working on 2 more, Swahili and Maasai. They took an unspoken language, created an alphabet, while also teaching the gospel. They built homes for numerous missionaries in the remotest part of the world. They traveled into war-torn South Sudan to help build a hospital. They helped heal countless illnesses. They facilitated in the digging of a dozen or so boreholes of fresh water, feeding programs for thousands of children and widows, widow empowerment programs, and the list could go on. They would say there was nothing special about them, though through the years, and with some reflection, I've come to realize there is something incredibly special about being willing to step out of your comfort zone on a regular basis, which they made a very good habit of doing regularly. I don't think the word no was in their vernacular. Whatever the need, they were there. Didn't matter if they knew how, they just dove in feet first. My father regularly said, there are no graduates in the school of faith. A couple years ago, he told me it never got easier for him. Stepping out into the unknown, stepping out on faith. He just knew he had to do it, and so he did. When I was about 7 years old, I learned a basic phrase in the local language that simply means, what dad does, I do too. He said it scared the daylights out of him. The realization that his every move was being watched and mimicked. Even though I have yet to lodge a fishing lure in my arm, I wonder how wonderful it would be if I could replicate a fraction of both of their faith. How much glory could be brought to the kingdom of God? In the end, it was nothing special that killed them. It was a car accident. I believe every single one of us had to take a car to get here today to remember and celebrate their life. We have no promises except the only true promise we have is the hope in Christ and Christ alone. Philippians 1, verse 21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. They knew their home was not here on earth. Their true reward was in heaven. I thank you all for being here, being a part of their lives, being a part of us children's lives. We thank you. Dave and Joy, we'll miss you so dearly. But we look forward to when we can be reunited in glory.
In many ways, I really don't want to be up here. My knees have been knocking all day. Something over this last week that I've realized is I'm internally grateful. And just as I was sitting down here, I realized the next thing I'm grateful for is the great, great brothers my parents gave me. Thank you all for coming. It is an understatement to say my family and I have felt the support of the entire West Michigan community and far, far beyond. To any Kenyans watching live or on a recording later, Karibu na asante, kwa msada yenu. Forgive me if my Swahili is not great. I'm not as good at learning languages as my parents. It's helpful to come up with some themes in a time like this. Where else do you start? What can you say for someone like Dave and Joy? And sorry, for any of you who don't know me, my name is Cameron Elliott Mueller, the youngest, favorite, and perfected son of David and Joy Mueller. I was once the smallest, but now I'm the tallest. Or as my dad would like to say, I grew up in everything but sense. So bear with my nonsensical ramblings as I try to communicate some of the life lessons that I learned from my parents. The first one being from my dad. If you see something that needs to be done, you do it. Don't wait for an order. Don't ask questions. Just do it. From my mother, be joyful in everything you do. And from the both of them, as a united couple, store up your riches in heaven and not on earth. It is impossible to pick one Bible verse, for the entire Bible was the very structure and foundation that undergirded their entire life. But James 2, 16 through 17 sticks out to me. If one of you say to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. This isn't a sermon, and I haven't been to Bible school, and I won't get into the theology of whether we're saved by faith or by grace or by works or legalism or anything like that. But I think we can all agree that my father believed that faith without action is dead, and he took that personally. Their gratitude, their generosity was overwhelming. Ian already touched on it, but it was a running joke. We could never own nice things. The second we did, my dad tried to find a way to get rid of it. Sometimes he'd sell it, but would barely break even. He would often buy new articles of clothing, shoes, pants, shirts, watch, all of good quality, fitting for a missionary going to harsh environments. He'd come back from that trip, and we'd ask him, what happened this time? He'd simply say, someone needed it more than me. For my mother, I know all of us have partaken in some way of her organizational skills, generosity, and food. Maybe it was a holiday supper, maybe it was a Can You Hope dinner or picnic, or maybe it was one of her expertly organized trips to Kenya, Sudan, or anywhere else. My mother loved cooking and was incredible at hospitality. She is a woman who never stayed in one home long enough to ever unpack the dishes that were given to her on her wedding day. But that never stopped her from hosting and giving to anyone who was willing to accept. My father was a master builder. You can find remnants of his handiwork across the globe, whether it's a cobblestone guard shed in the middle of Togo, West Africa, missionary homes in Papua New Guinea, ferrocement housing for his family in South Sudan, and a steel hospital, and most recently, over a dozen wells of fresh water, schools, churches, and homes for those who need it. Oftentimes, We think that in a moment of crisis, we will rise to the occasion and be the person that we need to be in that moment. Of course, I'd be the one to run into the burning building. Of course, I'd be the one to provide CPR in a car crash. Of course, I would be the one to say, "Here I am, send me," when God calls. But so often, we live a life of ease and pleasure and vice. This I am guilty of myself. But my parents made a habit and a discipline and a lifestyle out of the road less traveled, out of discomfort. They did not love discomfort for discomfort's sake, but as my mother put it when speaking about the slum in Kenya, name is slipping my mind, Kibera, thank you. She said that if you look past the rats and the refuse and the dirty water, you see people who need God's word and who need clean water. So they sought out discomfort because that's where they knew they could find the gold. I'm going to share one more story. It's an unpleasant story, but it's very appropriate. Long ago in Papua New Guinea, if I was born, I was only a baby. My parents, I imagine, had put the last child down for bed and were relaxing themselves before turning in, when all of a sudden they heard a knock on their door. A knock on your door at night in the middle of the jungle is rarely a good thing. They went to it quickly, opened the door, and found a large man, a member of the tribe they were serving, holding his young boy, 1, maybe 2 years old. He said, "He is not breathing. I don't have to tell you, but the body can go months without food, days without water, but only minutes without air." Time was of the essence. My mother rushed him down to her clinic, the size of a garden shed, quickly evaluated the situation. The boy's nose, airway, and lungs were quickly filling with a thick white mucus. Any nurses in the room know the situation and know the apparatus you would use in any Western hospital to remedy the situation. But my mother was not in the West, and she had no such apparatus. She had some sterile tubing and my father's strong, young, healthy lungs. She snaked the tube down the boy's nose into his throat, gave the other end to my father, and said, "Suck." I don't begrudge my father for hesitating slightly, but no sooner after that, he grabbed the hose. He sucked, spat. The events of that evening concluded. A few years went by, and their time in that village concluded as well. But years later, their paths crossed with this same man. Delighted to see old friends, this man told my parents to wait as he went and got something. They waited. Quickly he returned with a young boy, 8 or 9, I'm not sure. With tears in his eyes, he looked at my father, said, "This is the boy that you breathe life back into." My parents cultivated a life of hardship so that when the call came from God or from man, they were ready to answer. One more verse, Thessalonians 4, 13 and 14. "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him." In so many ways, this is an incredibly sad time. But also in so many ways, it's an incredibly joyous time, because we all get to come together and reflect on what incredible work and what incredible role models they were to all of us. Mom and Dad, I will miss you deeply, and I will do my best to emulate the lessons that you have tried to instill in me. Thank you.
Dave and Joy were truly one of a kind. They had an unusual combination of skills and talents and life experiences and passions. They gave the best years of their lives in service for the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's what they always wanted to do, to serve Christ to the end. I want to say to the Millers and the Muellers, I acknowledge your loss is very real, and yet I want to remind you that God is present here. In my own journey of grief, in my regular Bible reading, I was in Psalm 139, that beautiful psalm where David says, you formed me in my mother's womb, you knit me together, I'm fearfully, wonderfully made. And there's a verse and there's a phrase that I had neglected. It's in verse 18. God, the God who formed us, puts the days of our lives in his book. What on earth does that mean? It's not a book that I've seen. Neither have I seen the Lamb's Book of Life, but they're probably on the same shelf. You have to read the rest of the psalm to get the big picture, but we have to look to God in an eternal view to find the meaning of our life's journeys on earth here for a few short years. David Martin Mueller, a man of many talents and an undivided heart, he was steady. He wasn't flashy, he didn't need to be noticed. Wes Mueller taught him all the skills you need to be a Michigan man. You know, like fishing, but I don't know about the hook. If Dave found a pair of pants or a shirt that he liked and he was comfortable with, he'll wear it till it falls off his body. And last year, there was a shirt that faded so much, but Dave wasn't ready to say goodbye to that shirt. You know this. Joy, of course, another skill, turned the shirt inside out and totally remade it so he was wearing the inside of, instead of the outside. And that was so Dave. Amen. Dave was thoughtful. He was not a man of books, but loved the book. He was not usually the first to speak. How many of you here were here at the banquet on October 6th? A lot of you. You saw Dave at his finest. Great haircut, too. He was skilled with his hands in a way that marveled Kenyans. There wasn't really a mechanical or engineering problem he couldn't figure out. Sometimes that meant laying in the dirt in a road, pulling some part off a truck so they could get there. You can study engineering and get a master's degree in licenses and not know what Dave knew in real life. I call it math in real life. A straight tower, a sturdy building, and so much more. Some of you guys worked with Dave, and it was the joy of your life to spend a few days with Dave making things happen. He enjoyed that as well. He always schemed to make it better. There were so many versions of the classrooms, the faculty houses, the cook houses, the wells, the water system. He said, Steve, we found a way to use 2/3 less firewood. We needed boilers in our cookhouses. Who knew? And Dave never gave up trying. This is the stuff of missionaries. There will always be setbacks. There will always be delays and disappointments. But Dave took the long view. Oh, sure, he was frustrated once in a while. Dave loved the Word of God. He wanted everyone to have it in their hands. He wanted those people who missed the chance to read to get it in audio form. Every illiterate Maasai to have the audio Bible in their hands or see Jesus speaking Maasai on the, who knew, on the Jesus film. David loved the people he served. He wasn't consumed with tasks that he didn't help. And if you go back and read that August letter about standing there watching them deplete all the water he just put in the tank, and just, what am I thinking? That's what it's for. We had 7 hope centers, and the needs are endless. There are places that need another opportunity. And Dave was always thinking about that. Dave once said, I love Africans. He was in his 20s, and I wanted to say to Dave, you can't love Africans. That's too vague and that's too big. And God got him there through a few twists and turns, but none of it disobedience, all of it obedience. Imagine a travel brochure luring you to the wonders and beauties of South Sudan. Forget it. You'll never imagine it. It was physically demanding like they'd never seen before. It made them long for the humidity of the jungles. There's a picture out there of Dave with a grinder, and he's doing something with an angle iron that's part of probably a water tower. And there's a little boy, you know the picture, and he's got his hand on that dangerously close, and guys, don't ever let your boys do that. He wouldn't do that, and you're iffy. But this is a new Dave. This is the grandpa Dave, and he allowed this boy to put his hand on his arm. Dave loved his grandson. There's another thing that Dave once said to me. If he said it to me, he probably said it to others. You know, I don't really want my sons to have children. Dave, you're nuts. Yeah, it's an evil world, and what kind of a world is that to be born in? Well, thankfully, God cured that forever, didn't he? And, one of a recent memory in my family is our daughter was in from overseas, and Dave and Joy stopped by the house, and my grandson was there, and he's 8.5 months old, and after Joy held baby Cole for the longest time, I said, Dave, you want to hold him? And he was an old pro. So which one of the four grandchildren so far will inherit what you can only inherit? You're born with it, the ability and the skills. Dave loved his wife. You know, they really were an unlikely pair. But they grew to complement each other. They understood each other. And so, yeah, I'm glad you figured out how to get the list of Dave-isms. I'm not going to quote any, but every once in a while at the office or even out in Kenya, Joy would pull out her phone and say, yeah, I have it right here. This is exactly what David said. Cherish those. He had a dry humor. He had a unique outlook. And these were all David's love language. That may not work for all of you, but Joy embraced it. And as has been said, Dave never really felt at home in the U.S. The better you do at crossing the cultural divide and closely relating to a people that God has called you to reach, it's a natural result that the more you will feel a stranger in your home. Dave had little patience for selfishness and prosperity. Dave had little patience for the life of ease. Yeah, don't doubt for a moment, David was a Michigander through and through. He loved the fishing, kayaking, camping in the forest. I mean, after living in South Sudan, why would you want to go out and sleep on the ground in Michigan and be eaten alive by mosquitoes? If Dave could choose, and we can't choose, he would have chosen, I want to live and die in Kenya. And so, in the sovereignty of God, which I do not understand, he went from Narok and the Narok Maasai Mara road directly to heaven. He died among the Maasai people. A man of many talents and undivided heart. Now there's Joy, and what more could be said? I'll be brief. Mama to the Maasai and comforter to widows. She did have amazing talent. She played the piano. She learned languages. You know, she was no slouch in the mechanical and carpentry stuff, too. And I figured Dave kind of made her do it. So if Dave was out and gone, not really a problem. Joy could handle it most of the time, too. She was a phenomenal cook. She could feed a crowd that showed up without warning, and they did. And none of it threw her. Life was always learning, always growing, Oh, I've never scuba dived before. Well, let's learn. Joy was also emotionally strong. Actually, the experts say that's one of the intelligences, emotional intelligence. She faced setbacks and trials. People disappointed her. They attacked her unfairly. People in whom she had put her trust proved to be unfaithful, tried to take advantage, but Joy knew who she was in Christ and was strong emotionally. Oh yeah, she knew how to cry. Joy persevered despite oppositions and setbacks, but Joy and Dave together had internalized what they call the spiritual disciplines. That's what sustains you in the ups and downs, the steadiness. Joy was creative. Don't ever tell her, we can't do that. That's too hard. That's what they beat into you when you go to New Tribes missionary training. But I still don't know of many who could feed all those people. Cake in the Wilderness, 2022. A friend of the ministry, Jim Beam, met up with Dave and Joy to help install yet another well. I don't remember which one. He and his wife had been in South Sudan without the Muellers, and so this time he came solo. And Joy somehow discovered that our wonderful Dave's right-hand man, George Wafula, his birthday and Jim Beam's birthday were the same day. I don't think George Wafula ever had a birthday cake in his life, but she did that day. And talk about making a cake from scratch. I don't even know how, but I have a photo to prove. She fed them chocolate cake, and George was beaming. I was with George. I'm not sure what day this is, when it was, but last week. And I want you to know there is real sorrow and grief and love there. Joy was the ultimate multitasker. Imagine a woman in a large kitchen with the ultimate kitchen, ladies, that you've ever dreamed of, with maybe a stove or range with 10 burners on it. Can you imagine that? Oh, for some of you, that's a nightmare. Sorry. So Joy would have a pot going on each burner. Can you see this? Each of it has needed its own temperature, and it needed its own ingredients and its own tending, maybe just a low flame here and a big boil there, a double boiler. And Joyce got all those pots under control. Don't try this. He had a tremendous capacity. Budgets in the Nairobi office, the next batch of widows to be interviewed, approving for sponsorship, the birthdays of the grandsons coming up, what's happening in our end-of-year fundraising push, the feelings and needs of her daughters-in-law. Oh, that was a good thing for them to get daughters. It really was. Joy loved the Word of God as well. It didn't matter where they were. It didn't matter what was happening. She was present in the moment. I didn't plan to say this, but I have to say it as a way of thank you. About a year ago at this time, we were in United Arab Emirates for the wedding of my daughter. And Joy and Dave were going to be the only family we had that could come, besides my kids and grandkids. Joy and Dave said, it's no problem, we'll take a taxi. That was a 100-kilometer taxi ride. And they came into what is now Caleb's house, and Joy was sick. You know, Joy, she had her medicine bag. You know the bag. How many of you have taken something out of that bag, been given something out of that bag? Just say no. And Joy says, I think I have appendicitis. And my daughter Julie said, you might, but you need to get to a hospital. It was Friday, day of prayers. And one of the groomsmen in their wedding was assigned to find a hospital that's actually open. And Joy said, Dave, you go to the wedding. Don't worry about me. I'll watch it streaming here on my phone. Can you believe that? Only Joy could do that. If I had to pick one thing, and you can't pick one thing, that would stand as Joy's legacy, if she would want a legacy to be remembered, and they didn't serve God for that, but if I had to pick, and no one gave me permission to pick, I would pick the Widow's Mite program. When you think of that, think of two Kenyans, Alice and Nettie, the face of the Widow's Mite program. In this vital ministry, I could show you pictures of Joy sitting sometimes on the ground, surrounded by widows who are broken and weathered and aged beyond their years, and now have the joy on their faces growing out of their hearts because they have hope. And because of loving, caring women like Alice and Nettie, who line upon line, precept upon precept, teach them the hope we have in Christ, who have gone through unspeakable hardships when the news spread around Narok town of this horrible accident, it was really hard for them to know exactly what had happened, but three different groups of widows gathered together in places and began to pray and cry out to God, not knowing, of course, that God's answer was already given. They were mourning. And so we mourn, but we don't mourn.
Let's stand as that hope is our hope in Christ. And as Forrest said best, in Christ and Christ alone is how we can stand here today. Darkness slain, then bursting forth.
till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. You may be seated.
When you give hope to somebody, and when you feed them, when you give them water, and you feed their flocks, and you realize, I've done something that actually matters.
There's nothing more worthwhile than bringing somebody to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and to be able to give them clean water, and to empower them, to lift them up and give them hope. That's what keeps motivating us and keeps taking us back to Kenya.
They lived a full life, amen. And they lived and served the King well. Philippians 1:21, the Apostle Paul says, what we see exemplified in them. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Dave and Joy lived as Christ, and they have gained Christ in eternal life. Thank you so much, boys, Steve, for helping us to remember, for giving us insight into who they were in so many ways that we didn't even know them. We thank you, and we will continue to support you and encourage you. The families asked me to do something that I think would bring joy to Dave and Joy, is to give a gospel charge. I can imagine, and I told the boys that Dave and Joy, the last thing they'd want is for us to be spending so much time thinking about them, especially when they know that there's a mission already waiting for those who go. So the charge that I have for us this afternoon before we leave is simple. Even as Dave and Joy were very simple, it's believe and go. Believe in the gospel and go take the gospel. Romans 3:23 tells us that we're all sinners. In order to believe the gospel, we must believe not only that gospel good news, but the bad news about ourselves. Believe that you are a sinner. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Many of us have an easy time embracing our culture's understanding that we're imperfect. But the scriptures don't just say that we're imperfect. It says that we're sinners. We haven't just offended anyone. We have offended the only one. That is the God who created us. You have offended your creator. You are a sinner. This, David and Joy embraced and believed, but they also believed that sin had consequences. Romans 3:23 tells us that we're sinners, but Romans 6:23 tells us that sin has consequences. It says, "For the wages of sin is death." Do you understand that you are a sinner and that your sin has consequences? It cost the Lord Jesus Christ his life. And this is the good news and the swivel and the hinge of the gospel that turns us from bad news into good news. In Romans 6:23, it doesn't just tell us that the wages and the consequences of our sin is death. It tells us that there is a gift that was given to us. It says, "The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Not only are you asked to believe that you're a sinner, and not only are you asked to believe that your sin has a consequence, but you're actually asked to believe that the Lord Jesus Christ and his death on the cross was for you. This is the message of the gospel that Dave and Joy gave their lives for. Believe that you're a sinner. Believe that sinners deserve death. But believe that Jesus Christ took sin on your behalf. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God." So the call and the invitation is to not only believe that you're a sinner, that your sin has consequences, but to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that he gave his life for you. Many of you are no doubt believers here in Jesus, but there are some of us who still have not believed. Maybe you grew up in and around the church and have since walked away. Maybe you attended Newhall. Maybe you attended Jenison Bible. Maybe you knew Dave and Joy as just someone who was passing along in their station of life. But the invitation for you is to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus tells us in John 5:24, he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life." Today, we honor Dave and Joy because of what they believed. They believed in this gospel message, but they also believed that there was a call to go, and go they went. The charge today is not only to believe in the gospel, but to go. Some of you who have believed in the gospel and you are part of the redeemed, maybe God is calling you to go to the nations. Maybe he has been calling you and you have had delayed obedience. Maybe not full disobedience, but delayed obedience in going to the nations. And perhaps Dave and Joy's life will be a catalyst for you in this very moment that God would send you abroad to the nations. The mission is still the same because the Great Commission is still the same. Matthew 28:18-20, Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always to the very end of the age." Some of you need this call to go to the nations. Perhaps you are the next Joy Mueller. Perhaps you are the next Dave Mueller who would take the call not only to believe in the gospel and be transformed in the likeness of Jesus, but to go and to change lives abroad by spreading the gospel message, even as Dave and Joy did. When I first took on this role of lead teaching pastor at Grace Community Church, I got a note from my secretary that said, "Dave Mueller wants to meet with you." I said, "Great, I can't wait." I knew Dave was a no-nonsense sort of dude. I knew he was a missionary, and as a son of a missionary missions pastor, I loved Dave and Joy from the moment I met him. I met him on a service project, And I love the fact that they knew how to work and work hard. The whole time we were getting to know each other, I don't think they took their eyes off of their rate. They just kept going. And as we were talking, they told me about their life and they told me about their story. And so I knew that when I took over this role, that Dave wanted to talk to me about missions and his heart for the nations. And as we sat, I'll never forget him telling me. He said, you know, Grace Community Church, I feel like when it comes to missions, we have a Ferrari, but we're driving it like a Honda. And I remember thinking in that moment, not only is he right, but I believe that there are many people whose lives are just like that as well. Perhaps you have a whole lot more to give to the mission field. Perhaps you have a lot more to offer with your life, with your resources. That perhaps you yourself are like that Ferrari, that you're driving like a Honda. And so the charge for you today is not only to believe in the gospel message, but to go to the nations. Follow in the example of Dave and Joy, who followed in the example of Paul and all of the apostles, and of Jesus Christ himself, who is the sent one from God. Before I close in prayer, I want to ask that you allow time for the family and I to make our recessional, and then you'll be dismissed by row. But I want us to honor Dave and Joy, and as we think of them, please continue to support this family. I mean, to think in one moment, your mom and dad are gone. I know that there are probably many who are eager to provide a Thanksgiving and a Christmas meal for you guys, and I've just obligated them to that fact. With that being said, would you please bow in prayer with me? Father, we come before you today with hearts that are burdened and are heavy, and it is right for us to feel this way. Jesus, we think of how you reacted when you went to Lazarus's tomb. You wept. And so, Lord, we weep. We mourn, we grieve, our hearts are drawn to lament in this moment. And yet, Lord Jesus, we also take joy in knowing that Dave and Joy are in your presence forevermore. And Lord, while they will not come back to us and we will go to them, we pray that in the meantime, we would look to their lives as an example, to be those who are sent ones, who care for the least of these. We thank you, Lord, and pray for comfort for the family as they continue to grieve this deep and tragic loss. We pray all of this in the mighty, comforting, wonderful comforting name of Jesus. And we all said,